chapter 6, tells us that a flood came on the earth. And the flood was a judgment from God. And so you have here in chapter 6 now the culmination of all of this. And we're going to see not only the flood, but the reason for the judgment of the flood. And I'd like to get into this chapter now because it's, I think, a very important chapter. And we find here, it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were very fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. Now, this sons of God and daughters of men is really something that has caused no end of discussion today. You will find, frankly, that there are today a great many good men that take the position that the sons of God here are angels. And may I say that I personally cannot accept that at all. Why? Somebody says, can't you accept it? And I recognize that most of my teachers taught the sons of God were angels. And I recognize that a great many of the present-day expositors take that position. I cannot accept it. Because if these were good angels, they would not commit this sin. And evil angels, I do not think, could ever be designated sons of God. And then the offspring that were here were men. They were not monstrosities. And I do not know why it is assumed by so many here that the offspring here were giants. It says in verse 4, there were giants in the earth in those days, but it doesn't say they're the offspring. It does say this about the offspring. It says, and also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men, which were of old men of renown. Now, these were not monstrosities, they were men. I've been reading the argument of one man. He says, well, they were giants and they were monstrosities. No, the record here makes it very clear that the giants were in the earth before this took place. And it simply means these were outstanding individuals. You know, humanity, friends, has a tremendous capacity. Man is fearfully and wonderfully made. And that's a great truth we've lost sight of. This idea today that man has come up from some protoplasm out of a garbage can or seaweed, it's utterly preposterous. And probably it's the belief now of some scientists that evolution will be repudiated. And some folk are going to look ridiculous at that time. May I say to you that it's nothing in the world but a theory far as science is concerned. Nothing has been conclusive about it. It is a philosophy, like any other philosophy, and it can be accepted or rejected, and when it's accepted, it certainly leads to some very crazy solutions to the problems of the world, and it's gotten us into trouble throughout the world. Anyone would think that we are the white knight riding through the world straightening out wrongs. We are wrong on the inside ourselves. I don't know why that in this country today that we have a intelligentsia in our colleges and in our government and in our news media today and in the military that think they are super, that somehow or another they have arrived. May I say to you, that is the delusion of the hour, that men think that they're greater than they really are. Man is suffering from a fall, an awful fall. He's totally depraved today. And until that's taken in consideration, well, we're in trouble all the way along. Now, what you have here is nothing in the world, but as I see it, this is a book of genealogies. It's a book of the families. The sons of God are the godly line that have come down now from Adam through Seth. And the daughters of men belong to the line of Cain. And you have here now an intermingling and intermarriage of these two lines until finally the entire line was totally corrupted. Well, not totally. One exception. That is the picture that is presented to us here. Now, I recognize, and I want to insist upon it, that the many fine expositors take the opposite view. The sons of God are actually angels. And if you follow that view, you will be in good company. But I'm sure that most of you want to be right, don't you? So I'm sure you want to go along with me here. May I say to you, regardless of which view you take, why, all of us, I hope, will be friends, because this is merely a matter of interpretation, and it doesn't have anything to do with whether you believe or do not believe the Bible, but does have to do with interpretation. Now God says here in verse 3, "And the Lord said, My spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. And we believe that Noah preached for 120 years, and during that time the Spirit of God was striving with man. And we're told, Peter makes it very clear, that it was back in the days of Noah that the Spirit of God was striving with men in order that he might bring them to God, but they would not turn. Well, let me read that. It's 1 Peter 3:19. Probably I should read verse 18. "For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh and quickened by the Spirit, by which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison." Now, they were in prison when Peter wrote, but when they were preached to, it was in the days of Noah. You say, how do you know? Read on, verse 20. "Which sometime were disobedient." When were they disobedient? In prison? No. When once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was a-preparing, wherein few, that is, 8 souls, were saved by water. When was it? Well, it was in the long-suffering of God in the days of Noah, those 120 years. Now, what was the condition on the earth at that time? Now, let's look at it. This gives the cause that caused God to bring judgment of the flood. This is verse 5 now, chapter 6 of Genesis. "And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." And you ought to emphasize these words. I have them marked in my Bible. The wickedness of man was great. Great is one. Every imagination, every. And that the imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil. That's all it was. And that continually. And you've got 4 words there that reveal the condition that was upon the earth. "And it repented the Lord." What repented? Why, the corruption of man. Repented the Lord. Now, it looks as if God had changed his mind. He created man, now he's going to destroy him, it looks like. "It repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. Now the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, and the creeping thing, the fowls of the air." Doesn't mention fish, because they're in the water. And he's just going to send more water. "For it repented me that I have made them."